So, tell us about Simon Cowell.
Okay.
Over here, people think that he can be kind of a jerkish sometimes, and sometimes he can have the biggest heart in the world. All depends how you crack his heart. Did you ever get a chance to, besides just being on stage, so like actually talk to him behind the scenes? Or is he kind of
Not really.
seclusive?
No, no,
He's
no,
too
no.
busy.
This is the hard question for me because I've got some real strong feelings about this. I don't think he really give as much of a fair run of the whip. I mean, don't get me wrong, I appreciate I do appreciate the opportunity,
Opportunity.
yeah, to be there, but I do feel that was more from, I don't know if you know Robbie Williams. He's a huge star in across the world. He's
Okay.
from my hometown.
Right.
One Direction, I'm sure you've heard of them. There's a
Yeah,
guy who was on that, and
yeah.
Robbie, and that we they were great, but Simon Cowell didn't really give us a fair shot, crack of the whip.
So
And I think
Dan,
that might be the way we look rather than the way we sound.
So to me it sounds like the same thing in America over there, politics.
Absolutely,
Politics
politics.
is
They
always
want this
involved.
new, 17-year-old Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
That's what he was.
So Dan, all right, so but you're on this show, you're in Wembley, you're in front of thousands and thousands of people,
Yeah.
cameras blasting all that.
Unreal, yeah.
You're going from pubs to being at Wembley, right? So what are your nerves like? What are your feelings? Are you and your wife like, oh God, please don't let us forget the words, or
It
you
was
know?
terrifying.
Yeah, it
I
has
mean,
to
bear in
be.
mind being younger, singing on live on TV,
Yeah.
but that was another level. So the way it was, you were the stage was here, you were here, so you had to walk up onto the stage. But normally, you'd play out to the audience, wouldn't you? That's not what happened. So you played on the stage, and you looked up, and they were all like in a square, going up really
Because
high.
of the stadium.
To it was terrifying. It was like something off the Gladiators or something. It was really intimidating, but we did it. We did good.
So for those of us that have never been in a position like that,
Uh-huh.
Dan, take us behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Did it tell you to be in a certain time in the morning?
Yeah.
Do you have to go to production, pre-production? Mike, to give us how a normal day will start before you're on TV that night. How does your day start
Well, I
off?
can give you a direct example of what happened on that day, just
Okay.
so, and because I've never really been in that position before, and to be honest, I don't ever want to be in that position again. It was horrendous. It was we were lucky enough to go down, get picked to go down to London because they really liked us, and we had some personal filming,
Okay.
and we went down there. This was at 4 in the morning. We went down there, got to London, and then we didn't perform until 2 in the morning the following day. So we were there for nearly 24 hours, backstage filming. It was horrible. And then after, it was actually the hottest day of the year in the UK. It was like ridiculously hot, one of the
Yeah.
hottest in ages. We had to drive back from my because I couldn't have any time off work at the time.
Right.
So I
Oh, so okay, so at this time you're still
I'm
working.
still working. Yeah.
And I guess your job is gracious enough to give you a few days off to.
Yeah.
So I'm sure all the people in your job like, "Dan, you really, you and your wife
I
really on
still had to
TV?"
keep it under wraps, so I could only tell a certain
Oh.
people because it hadn't been aired yet. So I couldn't really say too much. But it was so I still had work 7 o'clock in the morning the following day. So I had to it's 4 hours drive from London. Well, yeah, about 4 hours, 3.5, 4 hours.
Wow.
So I had to travel from 2 o'clock in the morning, half an hour. But we both fell asleep at the wheel, and you
Wow.
know that, I don't know if you have them over here, but like if you hit certain things, you go duh, 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 duh,
Yeah,
duh, duh. I don't know if it
yep.
does here. And it woke us up, and we had to sleep on the, oh God, it was horrible. On the
Side of
hottest
the
day of
road.
the year
Yeah.
in a service station on leather seats. It was horrible. But I wouldn't change it for the world. You know,
Yeah.
it's just another experience on my crazy life, to be honest, so far.
Wow.
Yeah, good though, cool.
What is it like? Because I'm trying to compare this to box, because boxers are on Wembley, they fight on big stage, so you kind of have an understanding what, how the heart is pumping walking to the ring, right? But in this instance, it's music, right? So after you sing, what is it like hearing thousands of people roar and cheer after you get done singing? What does that feel like?
Unbelievable. Yeah.
Can you just feel the chills go through
It's
you?
almost like you're numb for a bit, and then you kind of go, whoa, what's going on here? You know, when you're
Yeah.
singing on live on TV or something like that, it's almost like you're not really there. It's
Yeah.
almost the best way I can explain it. Have you ever gone on holiday, on a vacation, and thought, this is pretty nice where I am now, and but you know it's nicer than way the way you're acting. Right. You get back home, look at the pictures, and go, "Wow, that was amazing." That's you don't feel it at the time, but then after you go, "Whoa, that was something else," you know. So that's the best way of explaining it. Yeah.
All right, so you got the X Factor. You did this show. Of course, politics involved, but you still have boxing on your heart.
Yeah.
Even though your shoulder is messing, you can't really do it no more. So what happened that convinced you to say, you know what, I'm gonna try commentating? How did that first gig even happen?
It's so it's not something that just kind of sprung up around then. This is something I've been doing for like the last 8-9 years, but I've been doing it kind of more in the news, and then interviews and things like that. And then what I did is, because I had my own page, I've changed pages and names since, so people don't really know. That's why you don't know. But I did a lot of that, and I got a lot of friends in boxing because of the amount of people that I'd interviewed, and because I'm like, think I'm a really nice guy. Do you know what I mean? So I get on with everybody, and I gain great relationships with promoters and fighters, and you know, all around the world. What was the original question? Sorry, I do apologize.
No. So, how did you actually get into the boxing commentary? But you said you actually been doing it for years, but you actually got your age and stuff.
Well, I did the, I did the news at first and the write ups, and then
so a website.
Yeah,
and then you would just write up articles,
like a page on Facebook or whatever, or a website, write articles, speak to fighters. So I was doing the interviewing there.
So you were actually going to fights. Or would you watch on TV and then do a write up after watching?
Or I'd contact the fighters and I'd call them, or I'd, you know, FaceTime them or something, and then I'd start from the bottom, like so I'd learnt the trade from the hardest way.
So that brings me to a question. So I do those same things, right? But it's not always easy getting contacts or people want to give you their phone number. So how would you make those contacts? I mean, would you know somebody that knows somebody, like, man, you can trust Dan? You know, let me set this up.
It's the best way to explain this. It's something that you can't, and people have tried. People have tried, and people still try to do what I do or do what you do. It's not easy.
Right.
It takes years and years and years.
And they got to know you.
Hard work.
And trust you.
They got to know you, trust you, know you're a good person.
Yeah.
And especially in boxing, it's such a close-knit circle.
Right.
That you do one thing wrong, that the whole entire community knows, you're done. So I did it off reputation. So I'd speak to a fighter. My first fighter I spoke with was Frankie Gavin. You don't know if you know Frankie Gavin. He's
it was like a 140, right?
Yeah,
140 pounds.
Good fighter.
Ball hit it, right?
No.
Or he did.
He had his hair cut when he was.
I was watching him around the time that Ricky Hatton was fighting.
Yeah. He was Britain's. I don't know if he is this day. I can't remember now. But he was Britain's only ever amateur world champion at the time. And I remember interviewing him and my heart going but it brings the same feeling as singing. And it's a weird thing. It's almost like my whole life has been molded to do this. Do you know what I mean? From the singing and the performing and being in front of cameras, and then the boxing, the love of boxing, and sitting there as a kid with my granddad watching Rocky Marciano and reading the book. It's like my whole life has just been molded to do this. But then, to answer your question with the commentating, what I then started to do is then do Facebook Lives with fighters. And the more fighters I spoke with, then the more ones wanted to speak with me. And then
your reputation grew.
Yeah, my reputation grew bigger and bigger. Now I could never even imagine I'd be in the position I'm in now.
Right.
But my reputation grew and grew and grew. And then I speak to bigger and better fighters. And then because I'm speaking big fighters, all the big fighters come on. And then, you know, that's where I am now. But then my show, it developed from sitting there. I mean, I look back now and I think, oh my good God, what was I thinking? And you do, it's, you know, every day's a school day. And I think back, God, what was I doing? And then I obviously set my you know, it's in my house with my studio up, and I got better equipment, and I got lights, and I got backboards and sponsors, and nobody helped me. Nobody helped me.
Right.
It's all myself. And then because then when I was, because I had such a good knowledge of boxing, and then plus speaking with fighters, and performing led up to one thing, to commentate on something and what I knew best. So then I tried it and I did it, and I thought everybody was like, this is brilliant. Either people listening and, you know, all around the world, it was great. And then I did it again, and I did it again and again and again. And then different, just like before, different organizations, you know, reputation, they've seen me, they've seen me, they've seen me, they've seen me. And then the next thing I'm in London with Betty Earn, or I'm in Texas talking to you. So,